This session I will discuss about the measures of association. In many practical situations, we can identify various types of relationship between the variables. If you are finding out the variables, sometimes in most of the situations, we will be able to find out somewhat a relationship between the variables that we have considered. But if they are having such type of relationship between the variables, then we will need to estimate how one variable is related to another variable, or in simply how one variable is affected by another variable. In that situation, we will use these measures of association. As an example, if you need to find out the relationship between students' height and weight, then height would be one variable that we are considering and weight would be another variable that we are considering. And if you need to, or if you are suspect that there is a relationship between the student's height and weight, then you can check for the relationship between these two variables. It means that at the end, you should be able to comment that the height is affected by weight or the weight is affected by height. Likewise, you can have the association between the variables. And another example that we can consider is the relationship between the patient's blood pressure and the amount of drug the patient takes per day. Therefore, here if we are interested in finding out if whether there is any relationship between the patient's blood pressure and the amount of drugs that the patient takes per day. Therefore, these are two examples I have mentioned regarding the uses of the measures of association. And when we are discussing about the data, basically we can divide data into two types, qualitative data and quantitative data. According to the type of data, the test or the method that we are used for finding out the association between the variables will be again vary. Therefore, as an example, if we are having data under the qualitative data, then under the qualitative data, we can have the nominal scale data as well as the ordinal scale data. If we need to find out the relationship between two nominal scale variables, we can use the technique called the chi-square test. Then if you are having an ordinal scale data, therefore, if you need to find out the relationship between ordinal scale data, then Spearman's rank correlation can be used. And if you are having the quantitative data, whether it is in the interval scale or it is in the ratio scale, for both of these, we can use the Pearson's correlation coefficient technique. Therefore, we can use these techniques to find out the or measure the relationship between the variables. Therefore, generally for the quantitative or instead of Pearson's correlation, we can use these tests, but vice versa, we cannot perform that. But anyhow, for a place that we can apply Pearson's correlation, we do not try to apply chi-square test or the Spearman's rank correlation. It is because these are somewhat less powerful compared to the Pearson's correlation. Therefore, if you are having interval or ratio scale, generally we use the Pearson's correlation apart from using chi-square or Spearman's rank correlation. But we can use it, but we are not going to use it. It is because Pearson's correlation test is somewhat much more powerful compared to these two tests. But in the other way around, it is simply for the nominal scale, you cannot apply Spearman's rank correlation or Pearson's correlation. If it is nominal, then you have to use the chi-square test. If it is ordinal, we are using the Spearman's rank correlation. Now we will see about these tests one by one. First, I will explain about the chi-square test. Chi-square test is used to measure the association between the two nominal variables. If you can see the both variables in the nominal scale, then to find out the relationship between such variables or such nominal variables, we can perform the chi-square test. The chi-square test is based on the chi-square distribution. And in the statistics, we will discuss about the probability distribution. One of those probability distribution is named as chi-square distribution, and the chi-square test is based on the chi-square distribution. And if we are performing the chi-square test, generally we are using the two-way tables. Therefore, the calculations are depend on the two-way tables. Two-way tables in the sense that if you are using a table in this way, suppose that if you are having a table, then here we will have one variable, what would be are saying as the column variable. Then another variable, second variable, can be the row variable. Therefore, there would be rows and columns. Therefore, here for both directions, we are taking two different variables. Column wise, we will consider one variable, and row wise, we will consider another variable. That is why we can say this as a two-way table, and two-way tables are generally used to perform the calculations based on the chi-square test. If the variable is in interval or ratio scale data, you have to convert the variable into nominal scale data. Even though if it is in the interval or ratio scale, I mentioned that we can still use the chi-square test. Therefore, in that situation, what we need to do is we have to convert or transform these scale variables into nominal scale variables. But generally, we do not attempt to do it. It is because chi-square test is less powerful compared to the Pearson's correlation coefficient. The test statistic used for chi-square test can be denoted in this way. Chi-squared, here this is what we are taking as the calculated value. Once you solve this, solve the right side of this equation, then this quantity gives a value what we are taking as chi-squared, or sometimes you may see this as the chi-squared. This is named as calculated chi-squared value, or chi-squared. We generally say it as chi-squared. But actually, if you are obtaining, or if you are substituting the values for this equation, then you will get the chi-squared value. Then it can be calculated using the equation summation of I goes from 1 to R, summation of J goes from 1 to C, Oij minus Eij squared over Eij. Now we will see about these notations. Oij stands for the observed frequency falling into ith row and jth column. It is the observed frequency, and Eij is supposed to be the expected frequency falling into the ith row and jth column. If I explain it in this way, suppose that if you are having two-way table, one variable, there are two variables, then one variable may having, here I'm naming the first, okay, I will take this as the first variable and this as the second variable. First variable I'm considering as the row variable. Therefore, this would be the row number one, row number two. Likewise, if I'm considering R number of rows, that is why we can say first variable naming as the I, then I equals one, I equals two, I equals R. Likewise, I'm having the values. Then for the second variable, the levels are named as J. Then for the second variable, or for the column variable, we may have the columns 1, 2, 3, likewise up to, but we are having C number of columns. Here we may have C number of columns. That is why we are considering this I goes from 1 to R and J goes from 1 to C. It is because if you are considering this cell, it would be cell number 1 and 1, first row, first column. Then this would be first row, second column. Likewise, first row, cth column. In similar manner, here we will get rth row, first column, rth row, second column. Likewise, rth row, cth column. Therefore, this is the general notation we are having. Therefore, this 1, 1, 1, 2, likewise, we'll get the values as I and J. Instead of naming it as I and J, we'll simply say it as IJ. Therefore, Ij is the cell number that we are having, and Oij is supposed to be the observed value of Ij cell, and Eij is supposed to be the expected frequency falling into the ith row jth column. Therefore, if you are considering a particular cell, for a particular cell, you must have Oij value as well as an Eij value. Generally, we may get the values, and we are considering the values they are given for us, or they would be the observed value. Observed values are named as Oij, and Eij values has to be calculated by ourselves. The way of calculating the Eij value, it is supposed to be the expected frequency of ith row jth column, then it can be taken by this equation. It is the ith row total multiplied with jth column total divided by overall total, or the grand total. Therefore, using this equation, we will be able to calculate the Eij values simply. Now I will discuss an example related to chi-square test, and then you will be able to be familiarized much more towards obtaining this Eij values and how to get the values for this chi-square calculated or calculated chi-square value. But prior to discuss the example, I have to just have a hypothesis and the decision rule on this as well. Here, what we are going to do is we are testing whether there is a relationship between the variables or not. Here, we are not going to measure how close the relationship is. Here, what we are going to do using chi-square test is we are going to find out whether there is any relationship between the variables or whether there is no any relationship between the variables. Therefore, here we need to construct a hypothesis. And for the hypothesis, we may have two parts as H0 and H1, where H0 stands for there is no relationship between two variables. And alternative or H1 hypothesis would be there is a relationship between two variables. We cannot interchange these two hypotheses. Always H0 should be there is no relationship between two variables, and H1 or the alternative hypothesis would be there is a relationship between two variables. Once we have construct the hypothesis, we need to test the hypothesis, and to test the hypothesis, we need to obtain this calculated test statistic value, and then thereafter this calculated test statistic value has to be compared with the critical value, or in other words, we are taking as it as the table value. If the calculated chi-square value is greater than the table value, then we are rejecting the hypothesis which we have mentioned as H0. And if this calculated value is less than or equal to the table value, then we are fair to reject this. Therefore, in that situation, we have to accept the comment on H0. And now we will see about the calculation procedure. And here for your level, I'm not going to discuss about this chi-square C-1, R-1. Here I will provide the value for the calculations, but in the previous, but in another session, I will explain this chi-square test or obtaining this critical values in a different session. Okay, here now I will consider about the calculation procedure for chi-square test. First, we need to construct the hypothesis based on the question that you are asked. Then we need to determine the expected frequencies. It means that Eij values has to be obtained. Thereafter, create a table with observed frequency, expected frequency, and chi-square. Thereafter, we need to obtain the chi-square value using the formula. Then to get this value, we need to have this as degrees of freedom. It is number of columns minus one into number of rows minus one. Then we need to find out this value based on the chi-square distribution. But for the calculation, I am not going to discuss these two steps. It is because I will be providing you the chi-square table value. Therefore, here the method of obtaining the critical value is obtained by taking the degrees of freedom and using the chi-square distribution. Then thereafter, what you need to do is you need to compare the calculated chi-square value with the critical value. If the calculated chi-square is greater than, then in here, if chi-square calc greater than chi-square table value, what we are saying as the critical value, then what we are taking, what we are considering is we have to reject H naught. If chi squared calc value less than chi squared table value, then we do not need to reject, do not reject H naught. Therefore, these are the two decisions that we are taking. Generally, one would be really enough. If we are taking chi squared, equal should be there. Generally, we are using this only. We are not going to think about what will happen. This calculus, there are no equal table value. Therefore, generally, we can use this part for making the final conclusion. Therefore, if the calculated value is greater than the table value, then simply we are rejecting our null hypothesis. And now I will discuss an example related to chi-square test. Here, a table consists of the data obtained for 100 persons regarding their handedness, whether they are left-handed or right-handed. And we are asked to check whether there is any relationship among the gender and the handedness at 5% significance level. Now we can see that there are two variables, one variable named as the gender, and I have taken it as the row variable. Gender, it is male and female, then handedness taken as right-handed and the left-handed. Here what we need to check is whether there is any relationship among the gender and the handedness. Therefore, we need to check whether there is any relationship between these two variables. Here, for the handedness, we are having two levels, right-handed and the left-handed. For the gender also, we are having again two levels, female and male. The values or the counts obtained for the handedness and the gender is tabulated in this way. The 29 represent right-handed females, 11 represents left-handed females, 51 represents right-handed male, and 9 represents the left-handed males. Therefore, these are said to be the observed values that we can have for this calculation. Therefore, this would be 011, 012, 021, and 022. Therefore, without using the notations, we will try to do the calculation. Therefore, first what I have to do is, first, I need to construct the hypothesis. Therefore, I can construct the hypothesis. I have to mention both parts here, H naught and H1. Under the H naught, as given in the previous one as well, there is no relationship between two variables. Apart from writing two variables, now you can name what are those two variables that we are considering. Therefore, under the H naught, we can create that there is no relationship between gender and handedness. There is no relationship between gender and handedness. Then H1 would be the negation of this. It is simply we can say that there is a relationship between gender and handedness. Therefore, this is the first part of the calculation. It is constructing the hypothesis. Under the hypothesis, H0 and H1 is considered. Under H0, no relationship. Under H1, there is a relationship between two variables. Now, as the next thing, what I need to do is I need to obtain the row totals and the column totals separately. Therefore, here I'm having the counts in this way. Then first row total, 29 plus 11 obtained as 40. Second row total, 51 plus 9 obtained as 60. Then first column total, 29 plus 51 obtained as 80. The first column total, second column total, 11 plus 9 obtained as 20. And now we can get the grand total as 100. If you are taking the row totals or the column totals in both way rounds, you may get the same value and should be tallying, then we'll get the grand total for this example as 100. Now, what we have to do next is we need to calculate the expected cell frequencies. These are supposed to be the observed cell frequencies. Here, this is the first row, first column. Therefore, this is 011. Then 012, first row, second column. Then 021 equals 51. 2 equals 9. Therefore, these are supposed to be the observed cell frequencies. And now we need to calculate the expected cell frequencies. Using this equation, we can calculate the expected cell frequencies. Now you can see that the values mentioned in red colors are supposed to be the expected cell frequencies. If I do the calculation for the first cell, I need to obtain the expected cell frequencies. To obtain the expected cell frequency, what I am going to consider is, suppose I'll just take it in this way. Yeah, I will take the calculation. First, I need to calculate the expected cell frequency for first row, first column. To calculate this, what I need to do is, I need to calculate expected cell frequency for first row, first column. Therefore, first I need to take the column total and row total for the first cell. Now it is 40 and 80. Therefore, this can be now obtained by for the first row, first column. I can take this value as here I'm having value as row total is 40, column total is 80, then divided by the grand total 100, which leads to the value as 32. Therefore, here I am getting the value as 32. I will use another color. Here I will have value as 32. Then in a similar way, I can obtain all these values. Now here we can say it is 32. 32 is obtained as 40. Multiplied with 80 divided by grand total. And to obtain this value 8, what I can do is here, the cell contains value as 40 and 20, then 40 row total multiplied with 20 divided by grand total 100, I will get this value as 8. Therefore, this is how we are getting the row and column totals and by them obtaining the expected cell frequencies. To obtain this value 48, we can use the row and column total. Row total for this would be 60 and column total is 80 divided by 100, which leads to the value as 48. Then to obtain the value 12, here we are having, initially we are having only the black colored values only. Therefore the obtained values, the newly obtained values are mentioned in the red colors. Therefore to obtain this 12, what we can do is we can multiply 60 with 20 and divide it by 100. Then we'll get this value equals to 12. Therefore, this is how we are using the expected cell frequencies. Now, what we can have is, now we can use this equation to calculate the chi-squared value. Now we'll see how we will able to calculate this chi-squared value. To calculate the chi-squared value, we can use the equation provided here. Then here we can use them for the calculation. Then we can have Oij, first row, first column value is taken, it is 29. Then 29 minus Eij value is 32, minus 32. Then we need to take its square term, and then Eij is again 32. Then we need to take the summation, it plus. Then next value is, next observed value is 11, minus expected value is 8, square term has to be considered, then divide by Eij value, it is 8. Next one, observed value is 51, expected value is 48, here you can see 51 and 48, square term divide by 48, it is the expected value for this cell. Then cell number 4, observed value is 9, expected value is 12, square term has to be considered, and then divided by 12. Then once you perform this calculation, you will get the calculated value in this form. Now you may see the, once you perform this calculation, you will end up with the calculated chi-squared value as 2.3438. Now what you need to do is, you need to compare this value with the critical value. Using a chi-square distribution, we can obtain it. But here I'm not going to explain of obtaining the or using the chi-square table. Here I have shown the value which can be used for the calculation. It is the chi-squared 1 degree of freedom with 0.05, since it is 5% significance level. Therefore, we can get the critical value as 3.841. Therefore, this is supposed to be the critical value. But what we can see is our calculated value is somewhat less compared to the critical value or the table value. Therefore, based on that, we can comment on our final decision. Therefore, if you compare the values that we are having, the table value is somewhat here, it is 3.841. But our calculated value is 2.3438. Therefore, this is the calculated value and this is the critical or table value. Therefore, we can see that calculated value is just below or lower than the critical value. Therefore, we can say that calculated value less than the table value. Therefore, we are failed to reject the null hypothesis. Therefore, we are failed to reject, in the sense we are failed to reject the H naught. Always we are commenting on H naught only. We are failed to reject this hypothesis. Therefore, we have to comment that there is no relationship between gender and handedness. It is because now we according to the results that we are getting, we are failed to reject this. We are failed to reject, in the sense we need to accept this. If you are failing to reject, in the sense we need to accept it. Therefore, we have to accept the hypothesis saying that there is no relationship between the gender and handedness. Therefore, we can comment on that as well. As the conclusion, we can say that there is no relationship between the gender and the handedness. And there is an exercise provided for you, and you can try for this exercise, and you can be familiar with the calculation. This is all what I need to discuss for this session, and thank you all for your participation.